Okay, so let's go back to the scientific content of the meeting, and as Dr. Lawrence mentioned before, we're going to speak a little bit about vitamin D, which is in this part of the world a quite relevant topic, and the concept is what do we know today in 2018? And as we heard yesterday in the pre-Congress meeting, we know a few things about vitamin D. It's a group of secosterols. It's a compound that is well known for the implications in the bone metabolism. In humans, we have two key compounds, the D2 and D3, which is not exactly the same and is not always active, and is mainly acquired by the diet, in fatty acids, in the milk, in the egg yolk. That's where we get the vitamin D, and also through sun exposure. And as you can see, see if I have a pointer here, you can see the whole circuit of how you get the vitamin D3 from the diet and the sun. This has to be hydroxylated twice, first in the liver, and then second time in the kidneys, and this is what becomes active. And this is important because when we talk about treating with vitamin D or measuring vitamin D in serum, we have to understand what are we measuring, actually, because only the active form, the 125 dehydroxy vitamin D, the calcitriol, this is the active form, as you know, is going to act through the receptor, vitamin D receptor, that we know that there exists in several tissues, in the ovary, in the endometrium, in the testes, and in the placenta. The vitamin D receptor regulates a lot of genes, and this has been involved in many molecular events, in cell growth, in the genesis of cancer, hypertension, cardiovascular diabetes, even autoimmune diseases. So it seems that it's involved in many, many events, and of course in human reproduction. And this became a trend, and now everyone is measuring vitamin D for many different reasons. And this is what, in 2010, the Institute of Medicine and the Endocrine Society, 1 year later, defined at the normal levels. They said we should have adequate levels beyond 30 nanograms per ml, otherwise you will be sufficient or deficient. And what we need to know is what are we measuring when we talk about this? And we are not measuring the active form. This is not the 125 dehydroxyvitamin D. We're measuring one step before because it's much more stable in the blood. So this is the issue number one that we have to remember when we talk about vitamin D, which part of the whole process are we measuring? And it has been involved, as I said, in many events of human reproduction, male factor, pregnancy loss, endometriosis, PCO, you name it, and of course female infertility. And there are a few data that we have to have in mind. First of all, it seems that it's like a global pandemic disease. About 30% of reproductive age females are deficient for vitamin D. So if this had a huge impact in reproduction, this would be a huge drama. And it seemed quite simple. You have low vitamin D, you treat with supplements, and then you're fertile. And we know it's not that simple. We have ethnic differences, and there's a lot of papers out there showing how the prevalence of insufficient vitamin D may change according to the ethnic origin in Black Americans, in Hispanics, Iran, Saudi Arabia, and this is related not only to the diet of this population, but also on the sunlight exposure. And Professor Fateni showed in his presentation at the beginning one of the publications where there's even an influence of the dress code on your vitamin D levels, which I think is quite interesting to know, especially in this part of the world. But going to science, vitamin D and vitamin D receptor is crucial for the action, and we know that if we have a null mice, we remove the vitamin D receptor from the mice, we're going to have uterine hypoplasia, we're going to have impaired folliculogenesis, we're going to have a huge decline in fertility rate down to 75%, and a smaller litter size. So this means that we need this vitamin D to have normal reproduction in mice. And this was the first report to show a correlation between vitamin D levels and IVF outcomes. This is 2010, not so long ago, 8 years ago. And this paper from Oskam, published in Fertility and Sterility, showed that if you have low vitamin D, you have lower chances of being pregnant. This is vitamin D in follicular fluid. They look also at tertiles, they divide it by groups, and you see that the lower the vitamin D, the lower the chances of implantation and pregnancy rate. If you read this paper, you think that, of course, I need to supplement my patients with vitamin D, because more or less you get a 7% increase per nanogram of vitamin D. They found no difference in the ovarian response, no difference in the ovarian reserve, so maybe this was mediated through the endometrium. But all this data was based in 26 pregnancies, only 26 pregnancies. So it could be a slightly biased, and you could have this, the classical type 2 error, that because the sample size is so limited, you could be confused. Then larger papers appear, and you have one of the largest reports comes from Brussels. This is Nikos Polithos, who published a few years ago that, again, if you have in a much larger population, almost 400 patients, this is more significant. If you have low vitamin D, you have lower outcome. But again, this is just an association data. It's not a causality. We don't know if this, again, involved endometrium. But interestingly, when they look at the data from frozen embryo transfers, they couldn't find any association. So if it was the endometrium, we would expect to see these findings in the endometrium in frozen embryo transfer, but we didn't see any of it. And then, again, it was a large sample size, 280 women. And no association with AMH or AFC again. Then you have this larger study coming from the group of Richard Scott in EVRMA in New Jersey, where they transfer single embryo transfer, one embryo, one blastocyst that was screened through PGS, so this is the healthiest embryo we can find today. And they couldn't find, as you can see across the three groups, they couldn't find any association with vitamin D. So if the embryo was of good quality, no matter if the patient was deficient, insufficient, or adequate vitamin D, the success rate was exactly the same. And look at the ROC curve on the right side, you can see no predictive value at all. So if we look at the literature, we have seen quite a few studies showing yes, there is an association, and some other studies that say no, there's no association, and more papers are still being published. You have this very recent paper from the group of Anthony Duliva in California. He showed just the opposite. The higher the vitamin D in your follicular fluid, the lower the outcome. So it seems that it is not good to have high vitamin D. You can see in the right-hand side how the higher the vitamin D, the lower the chances of being pregnant. So it's quite counterintuitive. And here they showed also how vitamin D and AMH activity is going to be involved. Even though most of this vitamin D is bound to vitamin D binding protein and albumin, but again, you have an interaction between vitamin D and AMH receptor and what happens after the receptor. So vitamin D interacts and then all the transduction signals become modulated by vitamin D. If you look at the endometrium, we have data from one of the groups that studied most endometrium, which is Hugh Taylor at Yale University. And in this paper, almost 13 years ago, they saw the typical time course experiments and dose response. They saw that if you put vitamin D into endometrial cells in culture, you increase the expression of HOXA10. And HOXA10 is one of the genes that is crucial for embryo implantation, as you know. So it seems that the more vitamin D you put in culture, and the longer you put this vitamin D, the higher the expression in HOXA10. You can look at the northern blots or RT-PCR or the protein in the western blots. So why do we have these discordant papers, these discordant results? Why do we have such a different outcome? Well, first of all, we have to understand what we are missing, as I mentioned at the beginning, whether it's total vitamin D or it's bioavailable vitamin D. And we have to know that only 1% of the vitamin D is free in circulation. 85% is bound to vitamin D binding protein, and 14% is bound to albumin. And most of the studies, they don't consider the free vitamin D, they consider the total vitamin D. And also, there's a lot of polymorphisms in this receptor. So maybe this is part of the ethnic variations, that this vitamin D is not a receptor, it's not the same across ethnicity. And as I said, bioavailable vitamin D is not being measured, it's measured the total. And when you look at these particular issues, you have, for instance, this paper from Jason Franasiak, again from EVRMA in New Jersey, and they show that even the binding protein for vitamin D is lower in infertile patients. So this is going to change your ratio of free vitamin D and bioactive vitamin D. So what did we do? When we start to see this information which is conflicting, we like to test everything, so we did our own studies. And we did three different studies. One was with endometrium, so if the endometrium is involved, we want to check the recipients of oocyte donation. If it's the oocyte, then we check oocyte donors, so we can separate the oocyte from the endometrium. And then we look at the embryo, doing PGS and looking at any correlation with vitamin D. So in the first paper that we published in 2014, and Dr. Fateni was a co-author with us, what we look is what happens in egg recipients. These are women who are getting healthy eggs, and the recipient of these embryos has either normal vitamin D or insufficient vitamin D or deficient vitamin D, and we're putting healthy embryos into them. They are compatible according to age, BMI, number of transfer embryos and frozen embryos, so same quality. And if you look at the outcome, pregnancy rate is all across about 70% in this particular group of patients. And if you look at the RRCQ, whether you look at the total vitamin D or bioavailable vitamin D, we couldn't find any implication. So it seems that denormitrin in this large data set of 300 recipients didn't have any impact at all. If you look at the oocytes, again, we do the experiment on the other side. We look at 850 donors with different vitamin D concentration. Again, the same three groups, replete, insufficient, or deficient. You can see 251 with normal vitamin D, 443 insufficient, and 157 deficient, which to me is shocking because these are healthy young women who have low vitamin D in a country like Spain, where you get some from north, south, east, and west. And again, they have low vitamin D. Mean age is young because they were donors. They're compatible according to AMH values, antral follicle count, and oocytes retrieved, a mean number of 12 oocytes per donor. And if you look at the outcome of these 851 donors, which is a large data set, again, we couldn't find any implications at all. They had exactly the same pregnancy rate. If you do the same experiment, you do total vitamin D, RRCQ, and bioavailable vitamin D, it doesn't seem to have any impact. And then we went to the last part of the equation, which is maybe it's the embryo inside, and maybe because of this lack of vitamin D, they may have more errors in the mitotic divisions, or maybe have more chromosomal abnormalities. So when you look at the four different ways of looking at these vitamin D concentrations, we couldn't find any relationship in women who were under 39. Not in the group of 40 to 41, and we found a slight difference in women beyond 42. Like, sample size here is smaller, but it may be that in these older patients, low vitamin D could have an implication. We have to be careful, because this is data coming from all PGS. This was day 3 FIS with limited sample size, so we have to take this with caution. But there is data from, again, Jason Franesa, which is a very active doctor in New Jersey. He presented in ASRM last year, didn't publish the paper yet, I hope he has, reviewing a huge data set of PGS samples. He reviewed 1,229 PGS cycles. This is day 5 biopsy doing NGS, so this is state-of-the-art PGS. Mean age of these patients was 35, and what they found, if you see here, is that the lower the vitamin D, the higher the chances of having abnormal embryos. So it seems that maybe is the abnormalities that are being generated in the embryo. And if you can see, the p-value is close to significant, it's close, it's 0.04. But look at the normal vitamin D abnormality rate was 37.8 versus 44.6. So is this really a pandemic? Are we seeing a global disease? Maybe not. You have this editorial from the New England Journal of Medicine published 2 years ago, and it seems that we are treating all patients equally. We heard yesterday how vitamin D may change even with your BMI, so you cannot take the same cutoff for all the population. These experts mentioned that we may have an erroneous interpretation of the daily recommended dose. There's interpersonal variability in the vitamin D requirements. We don't need the same dose, all of us. And maybe vitamin D should be provided in high-risk patients and in disorders of the calcium metabolism. And you have this very recent publication in The Lancet from 2010, this year. This is a meta-analysis looking at the supplementation studies and all the prevention studies that were done also in other diseases. But this is mainly for musculoskeletal health, which is the major issue for vitamin D. And again, if you look at the summary, they say that there is little justification for the use of vitamin D supplementation to maintain or improve musculoskeletal health, except for the prevention or treatment of rickets and osteomalacia in high-risk groups. So again, clinical guidelines should reflect this conclusion. It seems that even in calcium metabolism, the implications of vitamin D is not as easy as supplementing the patients to have a solution. So to conclude, I think vitamin D has a clear role in human health and disease. The impact on human reproduction still requires clarification, and we have to still try to understand what is happening, because the initial enthusiasm seems to cool down a little bit. New techniques assessing the status will help to gain additional information. Vitamin D may be involved, as we have seen in folliculogenesis, in the receptivity of the endometrium, and in ovarian aging, and supplementing infertile patients with oral vitamin D supplements may not be as useful as we initially thought. Thank you very much.